Vernon, can we start this off with two compliments before we talk about your new movie?
Yes, absolutely. What you got?
Okay, first compliment. In the Madden video games, you're always unstoppable. And Chris Collinsworth always says that. He's Big Vern, 6'4", 260 pounds. You can't... Okay, anyway. The second compliment is it's such a pleasure to be connecting because as a writer who covers food, music, entertainment, sports, etc., you've been everywhere. We saw you on the Smirnoff campaign. There was a movie through PureFlix a couple of months ago, etc., etc. So I think you're on track to be one of those people that they go, oh, he was also a football player?
That would be amazing. That would be amazing. It's all about the work. You know, that's what I get excited about, putting in the work and just doing everything that I'm passionate about and just making a difference by inspiring people to continue to push and push on, because it's hard. It's hard to go from something and then hop into another thing. There's a lot of doubt, there's fear, there's all these things going against you. So for me to be able to be at the forefront and inspire people is all it's about.
Now, in the entertainment world, not just acting, you're also producing, you have your own company. But what exactly inspired you to enter this realm? Because let's face it, few industries are harder to break into than entertainment.
Yeah, for me, my backstory is I left college as an art studio major. And then when I arrived in San Francisco to play for the team, mm-hmm. I discovered that I wanted to open up an art gallery. And then from there, a gentleman came to me and asked to use my home to shoot a movie. And he told me that I would have a small role in it. So I did it. I gave him my home and I had a small role in this movie called I'm in Love with the Church Girl. Mm-hmm. Then I became curious about taking a class, and I was in a play at the Shelton Theater of Art in downtown San Francisco.
Right.
After that, I fell in love and I started to pursue acting even more. And as we all know, that when you're passionate about something, the desire's there, the universe forms itself around you, and it just starts opening up all these doors. And that's how I became an actor.
There you go. So this particular film, the person that I'm speaking to right now does not resemble the character from the film that much. So what kind of preparation was needed to get into this role?
First, I had to get a dialect coach, and then I had to go on Instagram and find someone who lived in South Africa to have them help me with some of the translation. And from there, I just put it all together, and just with repetition and consistency, I was able to tap into a different energy when it comes to the dialect and just giving the characters some more, just something else.
Right.
As well as the backstory of the character, what he went through, and what drove him to go after the things that he decided to go after.
Had you been good with accents before this film?
I've always been good with imitating different characters, from Forrest Gump to Morgan Freeman, and just playing around. So it's in my nature.
But you don't do the Morgan Freeman impression when he's around, correct?
No. I just kind of start sweating and my shaking and trembling. Hey, Mr. Freeman, nice to meet you.
Yeah, it's a fantastic cast, yourself included. When did you actually make the film? When were you on set for it?
I believe we shot this film 2 years ago, in the summer of 2021.
Okay, so in the midst of COVID. Okay, how long was it from finding out that you were cast in it to actually filming it?
Yeah, well, I found out, someone sent me the script, and when I read it, it had two characters in it, Vernon and another character named Davis. So I'm like, whoa, I gotta get this part. So they took another pass at the script and they changed it. The character, there's a character named Davis, but not Vernon.
Right.
So we kept him. And I'm thinking, wow, the initial script, this script is meant for me. So I sent in my acting reel to the producer again, and I kept calling my manager and saying, hey, come on. I got the part. Come on. He's like, yes, Vernon, you got it. So then right away, I started getting into the script and breaking it down and, you know, coming up with my choices. And next thing you know, we started filming.
It's not exactly the funniest movie on the planet. It's very deep. It's a thriller. There's action and all that. But is it still a good time on the set? Is it lighthearted the second that they say cut?
Yeah, absolutely. It's not as dark as it seems, you know, behind the scenes. You know, it's a movie. And just like any other movie, you make it and you have fun, you enjoy it. It's a journey that you're supposed to enjoy. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter if it's a horror thriller based on a true story. It doesn't really matter. You're still having fun.
You never know. There could be the one or two actors on the set who go method. And you can't call them by their real name ever. And I'm assuming you don't go method, that you're able to turn it off within a couple of minutes of them saying cut.
Oh, no, I go crazy. You can't talk to me. No, I'm joking.
Yes. So The Ritual Killer, again, is this new movie. And a lot of the times when you're doing a junket and you're speaking to the talent, you go, hey, congrats on your new movie. And they're thinking, this was 2 years ago. This is six movies ago, that kind of a thing. How many projects ago is this for you?
This is probably, as far as films?
Yeah. 15 or 16 movies ago?
Hold on. No. Hold on. Before this, I've done maybe three more films after this.
Oh, that, well, when you say 15 or 16, when you talk to somebody like Eric Roberts, it's literally like 40 movies ago, because somebody like him goes, you got me for a day and a half, make it work. And then so three movies ago. So that's very exciting. Are you also producing those three other movies that are coming out?
Some of them I try to produce, but usually the other ones, I get a role and I'll have a role in the movie. My biggest thing is continue to just work the craft, become really good at it. And then one thing leads to the next. Now I'm producing everything that I'm in. Eventually it's steps to it.
Wow. Okay. Do you have a role model when it comes to being a producer in entertainment? Because some people, they love movies, but they never think about who actually makes them. And they find out about that one mogul that's doing it, and they go, that's who I want to be. Do you have one of those?
That's who I want to be. Yeah, this is a lady named Cindy Cohen. And she's actually a good friend of mine. She's a great mentor, and she's just somebody who I'd love to emulate when it comes to producing film. She's always on the move. She's always on the go. And the thing I like about Cindy is that even though she's my friend, she's not handing me anything. She's not just giving me things. She believes in what I believe in. She believes in that when someone wants something, they should work for it. Hmm. Right? They should work, put the work in. Don't expect handouts, and just enjoy the journey. That's what it's about. And so I love her work, her work effort, everything that she puts into it, and she's a star.
So the thing that I'm picking up here is you mentioned that your first credit happened because they used your house and then they gave you a role. So you may not be here had you not played in San Francisco.
Possibly. I think the heart wants what it wants. If with me being an artist, I think I would have probably still pursued it, because there probably was something just like art. When I was in college, I was a criminal justice major. But something kept telling me to change my major and to pursue the arts, and I did it. I didn't know why. I just went off of pure feeling and gut instinct.
Hmm. The criminal justice part, that intrigues me, because I work as an investigator aside from all my interviewing and work as a writer. Do you think we'll ever see you have that celebrity show like Steven Seagal, where you're a cop and you bring peace to local neighborhoods and pretend to ride around the patrol car?
Oh yeah, I think we can see it. I think we'll see that one day. We'll definitely see that.
Okay, well, the last question I have for you before I let you go, obviously we're here to talk about the Ritual Killer, but when you're not busy with work, because you pop up in so many different places, where does your free time usually go? Because you've managed to maintain a mystique around who you are, besides being this legendary athlete who also has found success in entertainment.
During my free time, I'm spending it with my kids, my three kids, Valley, Valon, and Gianni. They take up a lot of my time. There's always something at school. And then my son's playing high school now. He's becoming a budding star in football. So I got to have to give him a lot of my time and energy, resources, and just making sure that he's on top of his job. That's where most of my time goes.
So it's not, hey, I'm at concerts four nights a week.
Yeah, and making music. I love making music, man. I'll get these instrumentals sent over, and I'll lay back, or whether I'm on a plane, I'm just coming up with these songs, and then I'll go in the studio and I'll record them.
Okay, so we might see a movie in the future where you not only act in it, produce, but score it also.
Let's go. Let's go. That's what I'm talking about.
Look, I am so glad to see you finding success in multiple areas like this. So keep up all the greatness, Vernon. Looking forward to whatever's to come next.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Paltrocast.